As I mentioned, one of the natural processes that's really important in ecosystems is energy flow. And really, how we see energy flow through ecosystems is through what we call food webs. Important point, all of the energy in food webs ultimately originates from the sun. We'll get more into this when we get to photosynthesis, but for now recognize that all the energy, even in your body, actually started with the sun and moved through a food web to get to you. So here is a classic food web. A trophic level is actually a description of how an organism gets its energy. And so let's look at some of the trophic levels depicted here. First, we have producers. And producers are organisms that can make their own energy. This is going to include plants, some bacteria, and some protista. They're going to have specialized organelles or pigments that allow them to absorb sunlight energy or convert inorganic chemicals into energy. And so they don't have to eat anything else. Those are the producers, and that's the first trophic level. The second trophic level are the primary consumers, and these are the organisms that eat producers to get their energy. We have another word for primary consumers, and those are herbivores. In this case, our deer is a nice example when it eats the grass of an herbivore. Secondary consumers eat primary consumers to get their energy, and these are carnivores. So our mountain lion, when it eats the deer, is a secondary consumer. I also want to point out that a scrub jay can be a secondary consumer. It doesn't have huge teeth and it's not an aggressive predator, but it's eating a grasshopper, which is a primary consumer, and so it qualifies as a secondary consumer. Tertiary consumers, this is going to be third level consumers. They're going to eat secondary consumers to get their energy. So if the mountain lion were to eat the fox, or the fox were to eat the scrub jay, then they would be tertiary consumers. They're also called carnivores. Anything that is eating other animals is going to be considered a carnivore, but there are different levels depending on which specific animals they're eating. There are omnivores, and omnivores are organisms that eat both producers and consumers. So they're going to eat plant material and other animal material. And of course, humans are a great example of omnivores. When you have a steak and potato dinner, you are eating producers and consumers to get your energy. Finally, we have the decomposers. And decomposers feed on dead or decaying tissues from any trophic level. So they don't care if you're a producer, primary, secondary, tertiary, or omnivore, they're going to feed on that decaying tissue. And this is largely bacteria, but it also includes larger organisms like this turkey vulture. When we look at a food web, we need to keep in mind something called the 10% rule of energy transfer. And what that says is that only 10% of the energy in any one trophic level is passed on to the next trophic level. So here's an illustration of the 10% rule. We've got a field of flowers that has 10,000 units of energy captured, but only 1,000 of that is being captured by the grasshoppers that live in that area. And the reason for that is the grasshoppers aren't consuming all of this plant, and the plant has used up energy and lost it as heat as it's grown, as it's created roots, as it's produced seeds. A lot of the energy that goes into a plant does not get passed directly on through the food web. Now your grasshoppers go through their life cycle. They hop around a lot. They produce eggs. They go through reproduction. When they get eaten by the mouse, not all that energy is collected. And then we can imagine the same thing with the mouse. The mouse is going to have some babies. It's going to run around and escape from predators. And finally, after a year and a half, it gets eaten by a snake. And only a small amount of the energy captured by that mouse is actually getting passed on to the snake. And in fact, the snake can't even digest the bones and the hair on the mouse that took energy, and so that's not being captured. So what you have is a loss of 90% of the energy as you move up the trophic levels. And you can see that has a dramatic effect. You can have a field with lots of flowers, not quite as many grasshoppers, not quite as many mice, and definitely not as many snakes. So the 10% rule is really powerful because it shows you that the amount of sunlight coming into a system and captured by those primary producers is going to determine the overall size of a particular ecosystem. So, considering the 10% rule, think about these two questions. Which ecosystem could support more organisms, a rainforest or a desert? Another question, why are there more deer than mountain lions in California? These can easily be explained by this 10% rule of energy transfer.